Hilbert spaces actually play a fundamental role in theory of coefficient inverse problems. So this research team, Lok Nguyen works with me in our department. Ko is my former postdoc. Li, she is our graduate student, aspirant. Astratov and Bini, they collected experimental data for me. So coefficient principle works for a construction of globally convergent numerical methods for a very wide class of coefficient inverse problems. So the problem is that this coefficient inverse problems, I call them CIPs by abbreviation, they are all nonlinear and ill-posed, in other words, unstable. This means that if you construct a conventional least squares functional to solve numerically, then you suffer from the problem of local minima at raw ends. Actually, everyone knows this, but since, except of my group, nobody is using this technique, then basically they publish something, but there are many questions. Where do you take first guess? How stable are you with respect to first guess? Many questions. So in other words, all what you can do is just in conventional least squares functionals, just minimize them, taking the first approximation from the blue, maybe God gives it to you, who knows? And then see how it works. And if it doesn't work, people usually say, well, what can I do? The method locally converges. Now, so Newton methods, all that is just talk, because they converge locally. So here is a very good example. It's not mine, by the way. It was published, 20 years ago in 1992. Scales, Smith and Fisher. This is a surface of the functional, least squares functional, for a very simple inverse problem. Well, that's not simple, but it's just, it may be simple, one-dimensional inverse problem for a wave equation. So what you have here is 55 parameters. No, usually you approximate a coefficient with parameters, right? For example, splines or finding differences or something. So 55 parameters and 53 of them are said to be correct ones, okay? But two parameters are varying, only two. And we see actually a terrible picture. Where should I start my minimization procedure? Minimization usually is what? Gradient-like method says, well, as soon as you have gradient is close to zero, then you got solution. Come on. If I started here, I get here. Start here, it's just unbelievable. Now, this is global minimum. Minimum is like maximum. It's just depicted differently. This global one. But there is no guarantee that the global minimum actually is your solution. There's only belief. Well, beliefs are in church, but not in science. Belief is yes, but actually it's not, nobody knows. But there are some even worse examples when actually you have plenty of global minima. Well, what does it mean, plenty? They say, well, their values are different by a couple percent, and then what, so what? Which one of them is yours? All right, so in other words, this is a very important problem because inverse problems are applied ones. What can I do? So therefore, construction of globally convergent numerical methods is indeed one of the most challenging problems of computational mathematics. One of the most challenging ones. And the coefficient method is basically unique at this point, globally convergent method. So, and the global convergence is proven rigorously and then verified numerically. Wait a minute. All right, so it's a rigorous proof of convergence. Furthermore, it gives you error estimates depending on the error of the level of noise in the data. And the key to all this business is the Kalman estimates. Because the main ingredient of any method of any version of the quantification method is Kalman weight function, which is introduced, yes, in least squares cost function, but all of a sudden it makes this function strictly convex. What Kalman weight function is? There are well-known Kalman estimates, which actually play a good role in this. The genius Swedish mathematician Torsten Kalman invented them in 1929, then they were completely forgotten for 20 years. And then Calderon gave them a new life. And the Kalman estimates were used only for proofs of uniqueness and stability of ill-post-Cauchy problems. Well, for example, if you have Cauchy problem for Laplace equation, so how to prove uniqueness and stability? You use Kalman estimate, just a simple example. And another sophisticated mathematical tool which I use is the tool of Riemannian geometry. So the Kalman estimates were introduced for the first time in the field of inverse problems in this work of Begem and Klebanov in Доклад Академии наук, Soviet Math Доклад in 1981. This is a breakthrough paper, and it was intended only for uniqueness, by the way. Since then, uniqueness theorems for inverse problems are proven only using this method, only. I mean, for non-overdetermined data. Overdetermined, guys, you can say many things about overdetermined, but I work with experimental data. I know how expensive it is to collect the data. I know how more expensive to collect overdetermined data. I see this by my eyes, okay? We can say many mathematical good things, but so what? So, but then, when coming to US, I significantly modified that idea and applied it to numerical methods. But initially, this idea was only purely theoretical, I mean, quantification, because I was afraid for something to implement numerically. And in 2017, using the help of my good friend Anatoly Bukushinsky in Moscow, we removed some obstacles on the numeric implementation, and then we started the active numerical studies, especially supported by United States Army Research Office. I don't have the support now, but it was for a long time, and it ended just exactly 1 year ago. Nothing secret, I mean, just open research, fundamental research, but they support very well. So now what's going on is that the quantification principle, various versions, works for very, very wide class of inverse problems. What I'm going to do is this. I will give you details of this principle just for one problem, including experimental data. But I have tens of problems. Therefore, I will not give you details for others. And I will give you just name one problem, which we are really proud of. And we will show some results. Now, what does it mean, globally converged numerical method? This basically means that we have a theorem which says that my method delivers at least one point in a small neighborhood of the solution, regardless on any knowledge of this neighborhood. In other words, you can start almost everywhere and just come to this neighborhood. And the distance between your solution and a true solution, your numerical solution, true solution, should depend only on noise level, period. This is, in other words, very strict requirement. We consider only the non-overdetermined data. We call them non-redundant. Now, by the way, I work with Army engineers and I worked with their real data they collect in the field, search for mines. And we got very good results for targets which are cluttered. They're covered by clutter, just in the field, you know. All right, so there are some other methods which formally converge globally. It's methods of Belyashev, Kobanikin, Novikov. Originally, they were for overdetermined data. Now, Kobanikin, Novikov, they incline to non-overdetermined data. That's so called for Dirichlet and Neumann map. Now, Dirichlet and Neumann map data, usually they are overdetermined. But we work with so called restricted Dirichlet and Neumann map data. Now, they are not redundant. They are not overdetermined. Now, before starting to present the inverse problem, I start from a mathematical apparatus. A special orthonormal basis, which I invented in 2017. It's very special orthonormal basis in L2. So the functions are psi n of alpha. They are, this is an orthonormal basis in L2 minus dd. They are smooth. No, smoothness is not a big deal, but what is here is a big deal. If you consider scalar product in L2, psi n prime times psi m, not just psi n psi m, psi n prime, okay? And then you form the matrix out of these numbers, mn. Then all of a sudden, mn minus 1 exists. In other words, mn is invertible. That's the key thing. Actually, Laguerre polynomial, regular Laguerre functions on a finite interval. But Laguerre function, nobody knew about this invertibility of this matrix. It was my first result. Why this is very special? Well, because if you consider standard tetranormal polynomials, for example, or trigonometric functions, doesn't matter. Then the first function is constant, right? Since first function is constant, then prime is zero, identical, and then you have the first row of your matrix is zero, therefore it is not invertible. I was thinking about this matrix for 15 years, it was not easy. So what should we do? We should consider these functions, alpha k e to the alpha. They are linearly independent, of course, complete. And then you should orthonormalize them. And then say k of alpha is polynomial of degree k plus 1 times e to the alpha. And actually, then again, the Laguerre polynomials, but on finite interval. But again, Laguerre did not figure out that this matrix is invertible. Maybe he didn't need it. So the matrix looks very nice, actually. Determinant is 1. But these numbers are not nice. The larger n is, the worse your numbers are here, okay? So we should play this game somehow. Now about the inverse problem. Since this was, I was working under support of Army Research Office, then they wanted me to search for mines using dielectric constants. Now the hope is that even though dielectric constants of targets, then this should decrease as the false alarm rate. They're suffering from false alarm. That's a problem here is. So what we have is, for simplicity, we have only cube as a domain. We have a line of sources, electrical sources, okay? And this, let's say, this is a mine or whatever, the target. And what we do, we send electric field here, in microwave actually, have backscattering data and measure it here. So the data are backscattering. What we can measure actually function normal derivative, I explain you why. We measure function, but actually we can measure normal derivative as well. So assuming that everything is described by the Helmholtz equation, by the way, what we can prove, there's a rigorous result of myself and Vladimir Gavrilovich Romanov, Academician of Russian Academy of Science. that if K is large, and if your electric field initiated by the, if only one component of the electric field is non-zero, then this component is governed not by the whole Maxwell system, but just for by Helmholtz equation. It's a very interesting result, which you confirm it many times numerically, many times. All right, so we use this Helmholtz equation. C is directly constant. Now, of course, you have Sommerfeld radiation condition. This is my domain omega, which I described for you, cube. And gamma is that backscattering side. In other words, this lower part of the cube. Okay, the line of sources is this. Line of sources located below your cube. No, I assume that C is C16. This is not a big deal. Inverse problems, people usually don't care about extra smoothness because inverse problems are so much complicated. An extra smoothness is not a big deal, okay? But I assume it just because I want to reproduce construction of Academician Romanov of fundamental solution the hyperbolic equation. So what is my coefficient inverse problem? I fix sufficiently large number k, which is wave number or frequency, if you wish, proportional to frequency. And I want to find this directory constant C of x. Assuming that outside of C is outside of the omega is one. In other words, you have air outside of your domain. If I know the following functions, the function u and normal derivative u sub z. And I complement this data, all right, by on other sides of the cube. Because otherwise I will have huge unstable problem. Like how can I complement? I assume that on other sides of the cube, I approximately have radiation boundary condition, approximately. If I don't do this, everything will be in ruin. So what I consider is actually a version of a classic Calderon problem. And we solve it numerically. And in the case of restricted Dirichlet Neumann map, you see, the data here are non-overdetermined. Why? These are two-dimensional functions, right? And alpha, which is the position of the source, is one-dimensional. So you have three in your data and three in a non-coefficient. Restricted Dirichlet Neumann map data. Now, why I mentioned the result of Romanov? Because using that result and one of the results of Weinberg about asymptotics of solutions of hyperbolic equations, we can prove this asymptotic behavior. What tau is? Tau is a travel time. As you know, if you have heterogeneous medium, then the time of arrival is not the time which you spend if you go along straight line, okay? We should go along geodesic line. So tau is the time of arrival. And z is positive. The key thing is here that this representation actually also is geometrical optics representation, but u is not zero. That's the key here. And therefore, what you can do, you can uniquely define logarithm of u. Very narrow, just taking logarithm formula here. You obtain this. So you can define the logarithm of complex valid function. But as I said, the key is that u is not zero, therefore, because we need actually only derivatives and derivatives of logarithm. Derivatives don't care about this ambiguity. So if I consider logarithm of u, substitute, you see I have only derivatives in that equation, Helmholtz equation, I mean. Then I obtain this. Nonlinear equation, nonlinearity is here. But this is very inconvenient because I have one equation one and two unknowns, like an NVN coefficient inverse problem. So what should I do? I should do the same thing as in this famous paper of Bugem and Klebanov. I should get rid on C. How to get rid? Well, I know that C does not depend on my source position, right? By the way, if I have single source, then it does not depend on K, and K would be varying. We have results about this as well. So, but anyway, in this specific case, I differentiate one with respect to source position and attempt test. Actually, this equation is absolutely horrible. That's what I was thinking for 15 years about. Why horrible? Because it's third order equation, you have V sub alpha, irregular derivatives of V, you know, just get crazy. To make it less horrible or make it solvable, what I do, I use that orthonormal basis, Laguerre-like basis, and represent function V like this. So Vn's Fourier coefficients are unknown. Now, whenever I publish a paper, there is a theorem. Whenever I publish this paper, always exists one, at least one referee, who says, what's going on here? Why don't you allow n go to infinity? What's going on with you? Well, I say, you know what? I have a choice. Either I fix n and I solve the problem, or I allow n go to infinity, I do not solve a problem, but problem has a Platt meaning. What can I do? All right, so in other words, I use approximate mathematical model. And there are many other people who are doing this with different bases. For example, I already mentioned Kabanikin, Novikov, but they use regular Fourier basis, and they do not prove that their inversion procedure is okay if n tends to infinity, never. Actually, this is a Galerkin method, but without proof for going to infinity. Now, there is another philosophical point, maybe you don't know, but it's a very deep one. Actually, if you consider optics, diffraction optics, okay? It's very well known, it's in the classical books of optics, textbooks of optics. It says, well, we have Maxwell's system, and we have Fresnel principle, Huygens-Fresnel principle. So entire optical industry, these glasses, all right? Work on Fresnel principle, of course. Without principle, I would not have glasses. But unfortunately, nobody knows yet how to rigorously derive Fresnel principle from the Maxwell system. All derivations have problems, gaps, including Kirchhoff derivation. They say, well, then therefore we have approximate mathematical model. It says in a classical book of Born and Wall, by the way. And then we have to work with it. Nothing we can do. Either you just close the entire optical industry, issue the law, until this principle would be derived from the Maxwell system, or you allow optical industry to work and think something, work on something else. All right, so this is a philosophical point, actually. So anyway, if I substitute this series, truncated series in my equation, then I obtain this, and then the usual procedure of Galerkin, I multiply each equation by Psi M, integrate as usual, and I obtain this system of equations here. And V capital is my the vector of my unknown coefficients. You see, the key here is Mn is invertible. Why? Because then, if I invert it, then all of a sudden my principal part of my operator, Laplacian, is free of charge. Okay, is free. But F tilde is a nonlinear term, quasi-linear actually. So, in order to have nonlinearity with respect to lower order derivatives. Therefore, if I multiply by Mn minus 1, actually, when we do numerics, we don't multiply by Mn minus 1. But for theory, it's necessary. So if I multiply this by that number, then I obtain this elliptic system, okay? I have Cauchy data, which I measured. And the third one is complement, as I said, I complement. Look, it's very clear why. If I forget about this one, okay, then what I have? I have Cauchy problem for Laplace-like equation. Adamar example says that it's horribly, horribly unstable. I must stabilize it. I must be practical. All right. Now let's go to Kalman business, as they call it. I consider this Kalman weight function. Lambda is large parameter, and it depends on z only. You know, there are sophisticated Kalman weight functions, but it's well known, to us at least. If you sophisticate, you have great theory, but it never works numerically. You should use as simplest as possible Kalman function. Fortunately, there are some. No, HK0 is space HK with zero initial conditions. And now the Kalman estimate. So if I consider this Kalman weight function phi lambda, then for sufficiently large lambda, which depends on lambda zero, depends only on my domain omega, I have this estimate. And this estimate explains actually everything. Why? Consider equation two again. If f does not exist, if f is zero, okay? Then Laplacian v to square is linear operator. Under some trivial boundary conditions, I will have this strictly convex function. Come on, just if I integrate Laplacian v square, it's not big deal. Strictly convex. But what is wrong? What does not allow me to do here is presence of this nonlinear term. So I should kill it somehow. And that's what kill is. You see, what does it say? But that here should be U, not W. That the Kalman weighted norm, that's exactly what I said, Kalman weighted Hilbert spaces. Kalman weighted norm of Laplacian dominates Kalman weighted norms of lower order derivatives. Which means basically that this one kills the rest, because lambda is large parameter. No, it immediately, I obtained quite interesting result, which was not known by me. Lipschitz stability for that problem. As soon as you have Lipschitz stability, you are you will be stable, you are ensured to be stable, and you will solve the problem. So Lipschitz stability means that if you have two pairs of boundary data, all right, and if you consider the difference, then you obtain the difference of solutions in H2 norm is less than difference of the H2 norm difference of boundary data, which is very nice. The result was unknown. Okay, now I will recall again our problem 4.5. And I introduce this Kalman weighted Hilbert space. Here should be integral, of course, over omega. Now what I do? Now I work like in your regular regularization theory of Andrei Nikolaevich Tikhonov. I consider arbitrary number R. What is important, very important, is that R is an arbitrary number, fixed but arbitrary. If I will say, well, R is less than epsilon, then this locally convergent method, which is absolutely unsatisfactory. R is an arbitrary number, but fixed. So now I consider sort of a ball, but ball is a sort of so-called ball, bounded domain, okay? Bounded set in H3. N means the number of, just direct product of N spaces, which this boundary satisfies the same boundary conditions, but the norm should be less than R. And then I consider minimization problem. Again, that's just by Tikhonov. Here is a not good. Should be phi lambda here. That's okay. Minimize this, and here is the norm in that Hilbert space, Kalman weighted space. North integral of this times phi lambda. Plus beta is a regularization parameter. Now this term, why do I use this term? Just to balance this two, because the maximum of phi lambda is exactly e to the plus two lambda. If lambda is large, then this term is dominating that one, which is not good for regularization. So we just balance it too. And the key result is that of strict convexity. First of all, for every V in this set, the function has Fréchet derivative. This is not a big deal. And it belongs to H301. Zero is important. So therefore, it has zero boundary conditions, which gives me opportunity to minimize, to consider the gradient method to minimize. Okay, suppose that lambda zero is the one which we had in column estimate. Then there exists another lambda one, which already depends not only on domain omega, but on my parameters, greater than lambda zero, such that as long as lambda is greater than lambda one, then for every beta positive, my function is strictly convex on that set. You know, what does strict convexity means? Well, this here it is. These are inequality. Again, you know, these are norms in this Kalman weighted Hilbert space. Well, actually, I must say that actually this term, the regularization term, provides me with strict convexity because it's an H3 norm, okay? But these norms are what? At most L2. Nevertheless, these norms tell me that I'm okay, not only in H3, but in H2 and most, okay. Is important for numerical studies. And another theorem, which Bukushinsky actually prompted me to prove and put it together in 2017, is that there exists a unique minimizer in our regularized solution in regularization theory. There exists a unique minimizer on this set. And on this minimizer, I have this inequality. So if minimizer would be interior point of the set, then it would be exactly zero, right? But it might be exist only on the boundary. Now, global convert gradient method, which I promised for a long time. I consider arbitrary point in that set on B, arbitrary, not just close to my solution. And I construct this regular gradient method. You see, because this function belongs to H3 0, then this function has zero boundary conditions. Therefore, all functions of my series have the same boundary conditions, very, very important, because I minimize it on that set. Now I provide error estimates and provide convergence theorem for gradient method. No error estimates, I assume, first of all, that I have exact solution like Poisson theory for noiseless data. Star means noiseless. All right, and I assume that I can extend my boundary conditions inside of the domain, extended, have obtaining H3 space that belongs to the H3. But then the noise in the data is less than delta. So star is my exact data and Q is my data, which I extended. It is less than delta. That's my assumption. That is error of, level of error. So now the global convergence of gradient method. I assume, actually with Bukushinsky, we have proven first global convergence of gradient descent, gradient projection method. In other words, you do not allow your iterations jump out of your domain, out of your set. But it's not good method. We always use gradient descent. Finally, I got a theorem which justifies it. So if we assume that my regularized solution norm is less than r over 3. Again, it's not local, because r is an arbitrary number. And I also assume that W star, V star, which is exact, also less than number R over 3 and minus this delta, a little bit less. And also I obtain my arbitrary guess In that bowl, no, of course, it should satisfy the boundary conditions. Then there exists sufficiently small step size of graded method gamma zero, such that for all gamma which has less than gamma zero, all my iterations, they cannot jump out. They all belong to that set. That's very important. All right. Moreover, they converge to my minimizer, in other words, regularized solutions taken, of course. How do they converge? There exists a small, not small, just number theta, which belongs to 0, 1, such that my iterations converge with the geometrical speed, the geometrical progression, to my minimizer or regularized solution. It's not easy to prove, by the way, for your post prove. It's very not easy. You should have, your operator should be well invertible. And because of Kalman-Knight functions, it is invertible. That's the key here. Even more, it claims this theorem that actually the difference between my minimizer or North's regularized solution and exact solution is in the noise level. North's my minimizer solution is very nice. And as soon as you have this and that, then triangular inequality immediately leads you to do these estimates. North's my iterates converge to V star. And the only thing which prevents them to converge correctly, exactly, completely, is delta noise in the dark. Everything is fine. So if n tends to infinity, then in the end, I will have the time in a level of noise. It's very nice. Now we have global convergence. Now, as you know, the classical theory for if you have non-convex function, then you have only local convergence. Any theorem about graded methods says if you start in epsilon neighborhood, you are okay. But what if not? Then you must have global strict convexity. Now I promised this sort of to explain why I was afraid about numerical studies since 1995 and only my stopped to be afraid in 2017 was because I was afraid for this parameter lambda. As you might recall, in the theorem, it says lambda must be sufficiently large. But if it is sufficiently large, then what? You have rapid decay of Kalman-Knight function, and it does not give you any solution except of small neighborhood of your boundary. And that's it, you are stuck. But actually, in the problem which we discuss, lambda is about one. Regularization parameter is zero. There are many regularization theories, okay? How to choose it this way, that way, but the problem is that in experimental data, you never know the level of noise, never. Because you must pre-process this data, you don't know initially the level of noise, you don't know how much would be in but before pre-processing, it's maybe 1000% of noise, all right? And if you have n number of Fourier coefficients, it's only six. Actually, we figured out that n equals 3 or 6 works well. But now the question is, why lambda is such a reasonable? You know, we have many numerical experiments with many problems. Lambda is between 1 and 5, usually. 1 and 3, usually. Why it's so reasonable? Okay, let's come back to philosophy, as I was talking to you about Fresnel principle. Now philosophy is this. What this theorem says about strict convexity is just actually asymptotic theory. It says, if your parameter is sufficiently large, then you are okay. But what any asymptotic theory says? The same thing. If your parameter is large, then you are okay. But it's okay in theory, but in practice, when you work with numerics, then you work with specific range of parameters, okay? And only numerical studies can tell you what does it mean sufficiently large. Is it 1, 10, 100? Only numerical studies can tell you. So now numerical studies repeated more and over and over and over again, and our lambdas are okay between 1 and 3 usually. Well, sometimes 5. So we actually can find simultaneously not only dielectric constant but also electric conductivity, because they are different in terms of this complex part. By the way, finding simultaneously is a big deal. Nobody knows how to do this. We do it. So now we consider it, by the insistence of Army Research Office, we consider it the most challenging case when targets are buried in a sandbox. Well, the imaging equipment, which is conventional actually, can, if you say, if your target, let's say mine or piece of wood, whatever, is in the ground, then they can tell you where it is located in horizontal coordinates. But it does not tell you the depth and does not tell you the dielectric constant. This is it. But then you have false alarm. So this is our real experimental device, which was sponsored by US Army Research Office. So in Marseille, French people also built the experimental device many years ago. Now their data are on the internet. All right, they try to be idealistic. In other words, they do not allow waves to go to reflect from anything in the world. We are not idealistic because we say, well, we will work in practical environment. As you see, the laboratory is filled with whatever you can find in physical, in laboratory, in physics, engineering laboratory. And this is our device. This is a sandbox. Just dry sand, right? And if you have wet sand, then electric field would not go through. So what we have here is some targets, like landmines, different shapes. They are buried in sandbox. This is an antenna. And actually, because we have, we cannot move antenna. But we can move sandbox. We moved 1 meter total, 50 centimeters to the right and 50 centimeters to the left. Which means that your source is moving. Now here is detector, okay? So whenever you send a pulse, it's frequency dependent. Then you obtain backscattering data on this detector. And then you shift the detector again, and et cetera, et cetera. So the detector covers the square 1 meter by 1 meter on this so-called wall. All right. Here it is. Here is just a confined schematic diagram. So first of all, I must tell you that the data looked terrible. Just horrible. And if I would say, well, I'm an abstract mathematician, I cannot sacrifice my rigor towards the problem, solution of this problem, then I would hand up and say, I cannot work, bye-bye, guys. And that's what any abstract mathematician, including Fields laureates, would do. Their mentality does not allow them to sacrifice rigor for the sake of engineering. Okay. My mentality is different. My father was an engineer and he taught me like that. So I said, well, it's horrible, but maybe I can do something. Not rigorous, but maybe I can do this. So what we use the just engineering trick, which they know, by the way, in optics. There are commercial software. We choose some kind of manipulations Fourier transform. In the end, it comes out to the truncating high spatial frequencies. Not temporal frequencies, but spatial frequencies. But actually, what does it mean? That we move my data from here to here. Move and lose something, we lose high spatial frequencies. So then I have data here. And only here, this is not rigorous, okay? But the rigorous procedure of confiscation starts here. In other words, I doubt very much that any kind of mathematics can work with this data. They are simply horrible. But these are pre-processed data. As I said, I have no idea what the noise is. Maybe 1000%, who knows? But these are pre-processed data, and what we see actually is very nice. We actually see projection of my target. The sort of projection of the target. Ah, by the way, why do I measure normal derivative? Because when I move from one wall to another, then I know my function for all z, therefore I know Neumann condition. Now, what we did, we challenge ourselves. We do most challenging cases of targets with voids, not just convex targets. So for example, this is just, look, mines, they have many different shapes, many different shapes. So this is one is letter O, metallic one. This image of the Dirac constant, this is electric conductivity. Of course, void is not perfect, but at least you see something. We should probably improve this image, but we do not have enough time. This is a bottle. What is interesting, this bottle is clear water, is exactly models the German mine, which was the Germans used in the Second World War. It was called Glass Mine 43, okay? Exactly models. So we see this, the dielectric constant is here, we see even a cup. Cup is not, of course, filled with water, but it is a sort of like water. And this is electric conductivity. Those were shapes. What about the electric constants? I promised, right? So what we have discovered by numerical simulations, that actually metals have sort of dielectric constants, although they're not described by physics. And these dielectric constants just have dielectric constants, apparent, I call them apparent dielectric constants, this high value of dielectric constants. Between 10 and 30. So we have here the table. For metal, we have 2878, my dielectric constant. By our simulations, it's between 10 and 30, so it's okay. Unfortunately, sigma is not imaged well. We should work out this better. It is imaged, shape is imaged by, well, it's not imaged. For water, with a glass of water, we actually measure it directly, the electric constant. As you see, it's very, very nice accuracy. Now we had one wooden target. We got 6.333, but by the tables of the electric constants, it's between 2 and 6. Right? And we had also letter A, metallic. 1624 again between 10 and 30, and metallic letter O, which I have shown is 16. So it's quite nice. Now, we also had before some experiments when we had single source, many frequencies. And we had purely dielectrics, like wood, it's different kind of woods, you see. Geode, which means sort of rock, wet wood, yellow pine, and all that. So we measured the electric constant directly. And we computed them. You see relative error between our measurements and computations is very small. And actually relative error is basically the same as the error of our measurements. So it's precise in the boundaries of error of our measurement. So we find it very precisely. Now, as I promised you, I have different problems. Travel time tomography is called also inverse kinematic problem. Well, plenty of people were working on this because it has huge applications in geophysics. And the first one who has noticed that and he solved one-dimensional problem was the famous mathematician, physicist, German, Georg Herglotz, in 1905. It is because of the work of Herglotz, why we know that geophysics know that the Earth has a mantle, kernel, and all that. Okay. But he saw that it only in 1D case, and many people were trying to do this in 3D. In a group of Lavrentiev since 1950s, actually. Romanov, for example, in one of his books, he has in 1969, he has numerical results. Very nice ones. You know, visualization at that time was horrible. But figures are nice. I mean, curves are nice. So, but everyone was considering the case when you have come overdetermined data in 3D machine case. And uniqueness was proven, and the group of women, all that. So overdetermined data in 3D case. In 2D case, no overdetermined. Nevertheless, the data you measured all around. But we had exactly the same source detector configuration as I have shown. And we got, I think it's measured breakthrough, first three-dimensional numerical result. So travel time tomography, tau is a travel time, as I have said, travel time between the sources and neural detectors. And you have a canal equation, which is classical. And coefficient inverse problem is this. This is the single most difficult coefficient inverse problem I know about. Because equations are nonlinear. And nonlinear with respect to coefficient, everything is basically horrible. All right? We have not linear parts here. So the coefficient inverse problem is that if you know travel times for omega, for boundary, and sources are on that line, then you must find n. So here how it works. Again, sources, this is your target, here it is. Now, again, I developed a version of the classification method with my Chinese collaborators, and we can challenge ourselves. Letters are very tough to image, very tough, you see. They have voids. Their shapes are horrible, basically, for imaging, because not horrible are only convex shapes, right? So this is a two-dimensional cross-section, a correct one on the left. On the right, that's what they image. Quite accurate, not only shape, but the function, unknown function, directly constant. This is a three-dimensional picture. Now, Academician Romanov works a lot on letters are horizontally oriented. Why can't you do this a little bit like that? I accepted his criticism and we work on this right now. We should improve our numerical studies. But nevertheless, this is a really first result in 3D. This is a nice laudation letter of Journal of Universal Post Problems, where the chief editor is my very good friend, Sergei Kobanichin. He had 70th birthday yesterday, by the way. You can congratulate him. I did. They published in February in this year, Journal of Universal Post Problems. And here's a medal, which I was handed also for my 70th birthday. It says, distinguished contribution to inverse problems field. So this is not Nobel Prize, unfortunately. Maybe I can receive it later, but this is something. Now, summary. Classification is globally converged method. It's a perfect synthesis of powerful mathematical apparatus with needs of army, which sponsored me, army, US Army. Classification is verified on experimental data. And by the way, other researchers also work on classification after me. First of all, this Professor Lok Nguyen, who works in the same department as I do. He is my former postdoc. Now, these are my great Chinese collaborators, University of Shenzhen, I call them. Shenzhen is one of the best Chinese universities. Chinese Harvard, I would say. But they have a branch of Moscow State University in the city. Jin Zili and his former postdoc, Wenlong Zhang, with whom we got, and Zhipeng Lian. Yeah, with Zhang we got the inverse kinematic problem. Now also Kirill Golubnichi, he works on gasification. Kirill got good result, how to become a millionaire. Now it's how to forecast prices of stock money, of stock options. I developed a theory. He tested on 26,000 real data. And you know what? We got only 12% of error in prices. Average error. Only 12%. No, and I must point out that a French group led to Professor Lucy Baudoin, I'm not sure I pronounced her name correctly, from University of Toulouse in France. They also got two good papers, very good ones, in the same journal American Analysis, also about confiscation. They cite me many times, but they got these two papers. No acknowledgement, that was partially supported by that grant. Thank you very much. I finished.